My name is TJ. I'm joined by Sottle and Brian Kibler. TV has some analysis and to preview this finals just a little bit. So Hot Meowth versus Tare. It's a little bit of an interesting thing because nobody predicted either of these players on either of the intro days.
Hot Meowth did.
Hot Meowth did.
He said that he felt that that himself and Tare had the best lineups in the event, and here they are, both in the finals.
Honestly, don't think that's strange at all, TJ. With our track record with predicting people on these events, I think the fact that both of these players' names were left out of our predictions meant that they were guaranteed to make it to Grand Finals.
We had, what, like 5 or 6 predictions across 2 days out of 8 players in this field, and we still weren't able to predict either, even anybody in the finals. So.
I just want to throw out that I called this Grand Finals at the end of the broadcast yesterday. I just want to put that one out there on the table.
Was it on air? Was it?
It was.
All right.
I don't think it was.
Check the box.
Screenshot didn't happen.
All right. Well, let's start talking about the first player in this final. It's going to be Hot Meowth, and Hot Meowth is a player that sort of floated under the radar for a lot of, at least us, and a lot of people here as well, but he said when I talked to him earlier the day on the stage, he said, "Well, if nobody's going to predict me, it sucks for them."
Nice.
because I'm going to take it. That was his words. And so, Sottle, what have you thought of Hot Meowth's play and so far his decks? What have you thought about his overall performance over the course of the weekend?
I think he got a little bit stuck towards the end of his semifinal series, but his quarterfinal impressed me, and his play through prelims impressed me a lot. So he's definitely come out as a strong player. His run through there, just some of the names that you can see him taking down, Just Saying, Phone Tap, for example, to extremely well-regarded players in the Hearthstone scene. So I think he's done well to deserve his spot here. I think he's one of the strongest performers that we've seen throughout these 2 days of Hearthstone. So no surprise to me that he made it here.
Yeah, and he was telling me a little bit backstage, he was saying that he was actually afraid to sort of play against Riv Trellin, even though he thought his decks would line up better, because Tare is sort of predictable. You can understand how his lineups are going to work, and Riv Trellin, you can't. And he also lost to Riv Trellin in the preliminary. So if we're looking at sort of some footage from the Zoo deck, and Kibler, he was in the same position today that he was yesterday, where he was up 3-0 and had to win with the Zoo deck. Is this Zoo deck a liability? Did he sort of steal a win in this situation? Will this maybe be a little bit of a factor in sort of a start of a downfall in the finals?
The interesting thing is he's going up against a lineup that also has a Zoo deck, and not necessarily those decks that gave his Zoo deck trouble in the previous matches. And it's not clear to me how these particular Zoo decks match up. The ability to come out of the gates quickly with the one-drop demon into Demon Fire is obviously quite powerful, but so is Sea Giant. And we saw just how much of an impact Tare's Sea Giants have had so far in this tournament.
Yeah, and Hot Meowth's decks are sort of just similar to Tare's, but just slightly faster.
Right.
You know, he's got the aggressive shaman instead of the mid-range shaman. He's got sort of a more aggressive zoo, more one-drops, less of those sort of situational board tools, more charge minions with the Argent Horse Riders. Oh. And I guess his control warrior is a little bit faster as well, because it's not an inevitable win condition, I suppose.
Yeah, sure.
I guess Yaxxaron is sometimes. But do you think this strategy is going to be okay against Tare? Do you think this is a disadvantage, him just having slightly faster decks in the long run?
I mean, I know personally between the two lineups, like you said, he wanted to play against Tare. He felt better there. Like you said, decks being a little bit faster in a lot of matchups, particularly the deck that just goes a little bit faster, especially if they get to go first and have the initiative, quite often comes out on top. But he was very, very scared of Roof Trellin's lineup specifically, not just because of unpredictability, but, you know, we saw the Wall Shaman, the Control Shaman being brought in a couple of previous HCT events for the purpose of beating up on decks like the kind that Hot Meowth has. So I think he's happy with the Grand Final matchup that he has, but I still have some questions to ask about his chosen build of Zoo. I questioned it yesterday, and he made me look a little bit stupid by Demon Fire Doomguard coming out and just absolutely winning a game for him against the Freeze Mage, but still not my preferred option of Zoo deck. I'll be interested to see how it performs in the Grand Finals.
Something about like 6 1-drop demons and Demon Fire.
Feels good.
It seems good on paper.
It does.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the Lance Carrier is the big question that I have with that deck. I played it, and every time I drew Lance Carrier, I just felt like, why do I have a Lance Carrier in my hand instead of a Hearthstone card? Like, what's going on?
The Kabbalist Tome of Zoo.
Yes. Thank you, TJ.
Yes, I understand you completely. But to get some thoughts on the first semifinalist, Hot Meowth, as well as some of his thoughts throughout the weekend, we have Pasqua standing by with Frodan.
That's right. I'm joined by Pascal, who joined us in the quarterfinals. Unfortunately, eliminated. That's just how it is. Only one person can win. And he wants to talk a little bit about Hot Meowth and his matchup, specifically against his opponent in the finals. So what are some of your thoughts? What are Hot Meowth's chances, even though everyone seems to underestimate him?
I think Hot Meowth has a really good lineup. He's playing really strong decks with the Druid, which is like Muzzy's got Rank 1 Legend. He's playing Muzzy's Zoo in the same way. He's playing really strong decks overall. His Hunter, since he's a Hunter expert, he's probably going to win. And I think Hot Meowth has a really good strong chance. He's playing the Dagger Shaman, which is proving to be really strong over the past few months. So I think one thing he might struggle with is against his opponent's Zoo, because he has double Sea Giant, which should be really good against him. And, well, his opponent is also playing the same Druid list, which proves this list is really strong. So both of them have a really strong chance with winning with Druid. I think one of the deciding factors should be their Warriors, because, Hot Meowth's Warrior is really good against aggro in general. But it might struggle against his shaman, his opponent's shaman and stuff. So yeah, should be deciding their warriors, I think.
Oh, that was a really thorough analysis. I don't really have any more questions. I guess the thing I just want to ask about you: how is your journey out here to the championships? I mean, you are the first Brazilian player to come through, and that's a really good showing. Do you think next year Brazilian will come even stronger?
Yeah, for sure. I'm not sure if I will be here, but I'm pretty sure that at least one Brazilian will be playing here, like probably two or three.
All right, two or three. We can definitely make our goals for 2017. Thanks so much for stopping by for a quick few words. Let's go back over to the sidebar and prepare for the second half of the analysis for the finals.
All righty, we're back, and some good words from Pascal there. He mentioned in his interview that he says it comes down to sort of their warrior decks, and you know the differences between them. Tare has a pretty standard C'Thun warrior lineup. Teray has a Kundun Warrior lineup, and Hot Meowth has like a very spell-heavy, super removal-focused Elise Warrior with the Oxeron. So what are the two sort of differences in playstyle, I guess, with these lineups, Kibler? And how is that going to be sort of a difference in this matchup?
Well, I had a chance to talk to Tare about specifically why he likes the C'Thun Warrior so much. And he said it's because he likes control decks. He wants to be able to play controlling decks. But so many controlling strategies are fundamentally reactive, while C'Thun Warrior has this very powerful proactive plan of, I'm just going to C'Thun you. And you can play these minions on curve with C'Thun's Chosen and Disciple of C'Thun, and then just build up to your Shield Bearer into C'Thun and just kill your opponent, which is very different than the standard control warrior.
And how do you think sort of these matchups will line up against the lineup of Hot Meowth for Teray? You know, he's got the C'Thun Warrior, but is that better than, say, a removal warrior against a field of Hunter and Aggro Shaman and... Or sorry, Hunter and Midrange Shaman and the Druid?
I think I personally would rather have the Removal Warrior. It's a deck that I've tested quite a lot since Karazhan came out, and it seems to be a little better in some of those bad matchups, like the Midrange Hunters, than the more C'Thun-based strategies, or even the Nazoth-based strategy that some people are using. So personally, I like the more spell-heavy version with the Yogg in there. Wow, that's probably the first time I've said I prefer a deck with Yogg on it on these broadcasts. But still, I think the Shamans will be a big deal as well, because matching up against the Warrior, you'd quite often rather have the Midrangey deck going up against Warrior, so that you can just leverage totems and out-resource them and go forward that way. So you can definitely see that having impact as well.
It'll be interesting to see what these players choose to ban in this matchup, because Hot Meowth actually mentioned to me that while many players have been banning Warrior throughout the preliminary, he feels his lineup matches up better against an opponent whose Shaman he gets to ban. And we've seen him do that in both his matchups so far. So as to whether he continues that in the finals, or if because his opponent also has Control Warrior, maybe that changes things.
We talked about it a little bit earlier, but we saw that clip. They have a lot of differences in their Zoo decks. Yep. And we saw that Teray has Forbidden Ritual. He's got the Sea Giants in this deck. He doesn't sort of have that discard or demon package. Is the sort of old school Zoo Warlock going to fare better against some of these decks? Because it feels like it's just more consistent across the board. Hot Meowth did struggle a lot to find wins in his match yesterday with the discard Zoo.
It's interesting to me. I think, personally, Sea Giants are a little bit overrated in Zoo mirrors and aggressive matchups where both players are trying to develop onto the board early, because actually in those matchups, a lot of the time, your minions are being traded all the time. Your opponent is just one for one-ing your minions, trying to keep the board clear, because both players understand that their opponent has the ability to leverage any minions that are left alive. So quite often, Sea Giant can sit around as a dead card in your hand in those sort of situations, and especially with the knowledge of the Sea Giants being there. It's not like suddenly surprise Sea Giant that you didn't know was in your opponent's deck. So. Again, I think I am I'm a fan of the more consistent Zoo, as you said, but not particularly because of the Sea Giants, just because of the tried and true Zoo strategy that, you know, if it isn't broke, don't fix it kind of thing that we've seen for many, many years with that deck.
Yeah. All right. Well, to get some thoughts on our second player, Tare, and his thoughts throughout the weekend, we have an interview with Abar on stage with Frodan.
Abar, you did face off against Ture multiple times in the tournament, not just here, but also in the preliminary. Now he's here in the finals. It's fitting, right? He took out the strongest opponent in the first round. Wink, wink.
You're too kind. Yeah, no, Ture is a great player. I do think he brought a very consistent, solid lineup, and I'm looking forward to seeing him play in the finals.
Do you feel like he is the favored one going up against Hot Meowth?
I do. From my experience, and I can't speak from experience, I do think that Zoo list that Hot Meowth and I brought is a liability. I just felt like it underperformed, and I don't think that was a fluke. I just think the deck has some holes. So it'll be interesting to see if Tare can take advantage of that with his more consistent, more proven Zoo list and hit some favorable matchups with his bans.
What do you think is the key to success that led it to? These guys are both playing similar-ish lineups, not necessarily the exact same 30 cards. Of course, they have differences. Do you agree with the notion that they brought the best lineup for this tournament?
Yeah, they brought a lineup that put themselves in a position to play against pretty much any of the other lineups that could be brought, in my opinion. Given the Hunter, gives them a little bit more flexibility to take on maybe a more control-oriented lineup. But then also, you know, with Zoo builds and with these Shaman builds, kind of aggro killers at the same time. So they put themselves in a very safe, comfortable position that's paying off.
Yeah, you're actually extremely well-spoken. You might be taking our job soon as casters, so maybe you see you as commentary. Congratulations on getting to the quarterfinals. Unfortunately, your journey ends there, but we'll see you back next year, right?
Absolutely. I will be back.
All right, one way or another. So this is Abar, who finished in the top eight against Tare, who did go into the finals as well, defeating his opponent, Abar. And now we're going to get ready for the sidebar once again to get some final thoughts before we kick off the grand finals.
Thanks, Dan. So Abar brought up some good points about sort of these two players and their lineup in general, that they sort of set themselves up to beat just about everything. You know, they have a control deck with the control warrior. They both have sort of aggro decks, but also aggro killer decks. So are you surprised at all, Kibbert, that this type of strategy worked out for both of our finalists coming into this?
I think both of these players have strong lineups that, you know, as we've seen, match up very well against what the majority of the field brought. So sort of in retrospect, of course, seeing how they did perform, it's really not terribly surprising to see both of them make it to the finals.
Yeah, there was a couple of people who I was asking earlier on doubted the strategy of trying to do too many things at once. Mm-hmm. But they were able to sort of beat the decks that had some control lists, like we saw with Roof Trellin in that last match. But they were also able to beat players that brought very fast lineups and aggressive decks earlier on in the tournament. So we're getting close to jumping into this, but I'm going to ask you guys a few more questions as we sort of preview the finals here. Sottl, if there's going to be a weak spot for Tare going into the final match against Hot Meowth, can you pinpoint what it would be?
I mean, I have to go back to the Zoo deck, you know, that decision. It's going to potentially... Matching up against the other Zoo is potentially the one matchup that it has in a really strong favorable position. But you know, coming up against, you know, heavy removal warrior with, you know, the additional life gain and all the removal tools and that kind of thing. So I think both players' Zoos need to pick up a win to really put them in a strong position.
All righty. Well, Kibler, I asked you already that question earlier about Tare. So I'm going to actually just go ahead and ask you for your prediction. And we'll go down the line here. So finals, America's summer champion. Who's it going to be?
I think it's going to be Tare. I think that he has the more consistent, more just generally proven and solid version of the Zoo deck. And as Sottl said, I think that's the matchup that this entire match is going to hinge on. For both players, I think that's their weak point, but I think Tare's weak point is a bit stronger.
All right, Sottl.
Couldn't have said it any better myself. Took the words out of my mouth. I completely agree with that. I think the break point in the matchup is he's going to come down to the Zoos, and I totally agree. I think Tare has the solid, more consistent build, so I'm going to go with him as well.
All right, well, I'm going to go sort of against the grain a little bit. I'm going to go ahead and say Hot Meowth. He's been on fire all weekend, and even though his Zoo was a weak point in his matches against Monsanto yesterday, even though it might have been a weak point today, if that match had gone a little bit longer than that and he hadn't got that Demon Fire for the Doom Guard to kill the Doomsayer, I think it's going to go his way, and he's going to be able to pick up a win with that. A lot of players have had consistency with that Zulok, especially in the Americas on ladder. Died his preparation, so 2-1. I'm going to look really smart if Hot Meowth wins.
TJ, you always look really smart. You don't need any extra help.
Thank you. But let us know at home who you guys think is going to win the finals and what you think of the finals and the Americas Championship as a whole. You can tweet at PlayHearthstone. Make sure you use the hashtag HCT. And you can also head over to Facebook.com/Hearthstone. Make sure you guys join on the conversation. I'm really interested in how you guys are thinking of this final. But it is about time. We're going to send it over to Frodan to let the grand finals begin.
8 players have entered, and only 2 remain. It is time to crown ourselves an America Summer Champion. It's time for the grand finals of Best of 7 to determine it all. Let's meet our first finalist, hailing from California. Please welcome to the stage, Teray. Teray comes in here having defeated his opponents all the way coming in from California in 2014, potentially getting another BlizzCon spot. I'll have a couple of words in a second, but let's go ahead and meet our second finalist, his opponent from the open bracket as well. It is Hot Meowth. Hailing from Nevada, no one expected Hot Meowth to get this far except for him and his friends. Come a little closer, man. We're going to have a couple of words for an interview. Don't worry. I promise I only have the softest of Pokeballs. Teray, I want to ask you the first question. You could be yet another person repeating a BlizzCon performance, but you look completely composed again. What's going through your mind right now as you prepare for this grand finals?
I'm just happy I already made it to the finals, and I'll just give it my best, and hopefully I win.
And Hot Meowth, there's been a lot of doubt on whether or not, it just seems like people are predicting your opponents a lot. Is it time for people to put their faith in you to be the champion for this season?
Yeah, put your faith in the Meowthcan, Team Rocket.
And there you go. He won't go blasting off this time. Shake hands, gentlemen. And let's get this thing started. Best of 7 to determine who will be the America Summer Champion. Let's get ready for the grand finals.
Thank you very much, Frodan. My name is TJ. I'm joined by Soddle to bring you guys the finals,
the America's Summer Championship.
Soddle, you look pumped. How pumped are you?
Wow. I think that's the first time anyone in my life has ever said that I look pumped. That is not a description that I'm used to hearing, but I am incredibly excited for this. I think Hot Meowth is, you know, a perfect underdog story coming into this. No, as Frodan pointed out, no one picked him for this whatsoever. But he just keeps answering the questions and pushing on through. And of course, Tare is the bastion of consistency standing in the way, trying to match the achievements of Kranich and now Tice to be a repeat BlizzCon visitor, which a lot of people herald as the biggest achievement in Hearthstone, right? They hold up that achievement from Kranich.
It's a really hard thing to do because a world championship is a tough road.
Is it really? No way.
Yeah, it's pretty tough. They don't just let anybody in.
Okay.
You have to, you know, qualify for the preliminary by earning points. Mm-hmm. Then you have to make it through a huge preliminary to get to the top 8. And then you have to beat the field of the top 8 players in your region. Beat them, not even get like top 2 or top 4.
Oh, yeah.
You have to beat them. So this is an important match. Teray said earlier in his interview with Dan, he said that, you know, he thinks his experience is what's giving him an edge in a lot of these matches. And he does look calm. He's looked calm in every single match. Even the games that he's lost, he just shakes them off, cues up the next one, and does his thing.
Sure does, but we are just about ready to go with our grand finals. I mean, it's going to be Zoo coming up against the Shaman, and I think this particular matchup, I don't know if you agree with this, TJ, but it's one of the big contributors to, you know, Zoo being brought to tournaments less often in the last couple of weeks. It's because, you know, Zoo was almost positioned second in the power decks, you know, between the Dragon Warrior, the Aggro Shaman, and the Zoo that everyone was bringing a while back. Mm-hmm. But now with the introduction of Spirit Claws and Maelstrom Portal to Shaman has just kind of leapt up to be able to win the matchup against Zoo now.
Yeah, that's very true, actually. And I think that It has gone that way, but this is sort of a zoo from a little bit ago, I suppose, with just one Maelstrom Portal. It doesn't run the Spirit Claws. It runs a single copy of Lightning Storm.
Yep.
I mean, Athirty does have the Lightning Storm in his hand, but it's not necessarily the only card that you need. You need sort of cards to back that up early on if you're going to want to take control of the board after you've cleared the zoos with that Lightning Storm.
Right, and absolutely. In a lot of situations, the Maelstrom Portal is just preferable because it's a card you can play without losing tempo. Quite often, you know, Lightning Storm relieves some pressure, but it doesn't do anything to do what you need to do in this matchup, which is to get yourself ahead on the board for a turn.
Maelstrom Portal is sort of like a miniature Ravaging Ghoul.
Yes.
That's affected by spell power, and that's probably not quite as strong of a body.
When you put it that way, TJ, it sounds like a very, very strong card.
I could sell anything.
Ooh, sell me that chair, TJ.
No, not as good as Teray, actually. Mm-hmm. Not as good as Teray. This chair won't make you win all of your Hearthstone matches, unfortunately, for me. But yeah, Hot Meowth, this is sort of one of those things that makes Shaman struggle in this matchup. Zoo is almost always going to have stuff to play onto the board. They're almost always going to have minions.
Yep.
Whereas Shaman has much more situational tools. They have a lot of bigger stuff that doesn't allow them to get on the board as quickly. He does have Flame Your Faces, which if it sticks can do a lot. But you know, passing a turn is not what you want in this matchup.
It really isn't. And what's important here, potentially for Hot Meowth, is there isn't a huge development turn here for Tare. It looks like he might be considering just the Possessed Villager here. And if he does that, this is a fairly weak board that Hot Meowth, his eyes will light up. Like maybe he can get a Flame Wreath Faceless to stick on this board and start dominating. The Power Overwhelming and Soulfire that back that up from Tare's hand will have something to say about that, though.
Yeah, Tare is, he's debating on whether or not to play Possessed Villager and a Forbidden Ritual for two.
Mm-hmm.
Or play just the Forbidden Ritual. I kind of liked it the other way around. If your opponent passes on turn three, you can expect that they're going to be playing Flame Your Faces on turn four. And I feel like Possessed Villager with the Power Bombing matches up a little bit better. And also, if you have a Soulfire in your hand, that's something that you want to get rid of pretty quickly as well. And you don't want to have sort of a clunky hand to be able to make that happen. If he plays Possessed Villager last turn, it allows him to play it as up to a two drop in his deck.
Yeah.
Instead of only a one drop in order to activate Soulfire on the same turn.
Yeah, it would make a huge difference if, for example, there was one more tentacle being summoned here, if it was a 4-mana turn instead of a 3-mana turn, because that way he could at least just straight up conga line his 1/1s into the 7/7 and retain the Power Overwhelming if he wanted to. But he is going to need to use one of the additional sources of damage to deal with the 7/7 unless he just chooses to straight up ignore it. So I do agree with you, I'd like to see the Villager come down that turn, but now Hot Meowth is looking to go a little bit wider than just that one big target on the board, recognizing that that can get isolated just by what he can see. And chooses to go with the Tuskar Totemic instead, but just gets a base totem, which is going to leave him behind on this board. But the important decision there is that he chose not to overreact and just snap Lightning Storm away that board that maybe a lot of newer players may have looked at, because he understands that that passes the initiative fully back to the zoo and will give him a terrible turn next turn.
This has been a pretty cool game so far for game one in this series, because Hot Meowth realize that one of the big conditions here is to just sort of play a little bit grindy, try and bait out a good Lightning Storm, and also to be able to follow that up, the Lightning Storm up with a big play, is actually a huge deal, because
Ooh.
The Zoo Warlock is going to reload. That is not the greatest.
Yeah, that is very weak. I mean, I don't want to say fortunate because he has incredible odds to hit it, but if there was Life Tap into, you know, a large minion that he couldn't play, say a Doomguard or just another situational card, that would have been an incredibly poor turn here from Teray. Like, Argent Squire, not the greatest, but just that little extra bit of initiative on the board that he can now back up with all these power cards in his hand should be enough to keep him ahead just for now at least.
Probably pretty happy to just see one sort of big minion here.
Yes.
Because he can actually kill it, but not happy to see Forbidden Ritual. It sort of has anti-synergy with Soulfire, because if you use it first, then there's no way you can get Soulfire that turn, but you can't play Soulfire. Is going to discard Forbidden Ritual if you save it for last. A little bit of anti-synergy there. Teray trying to find the most efficient way to clear this. And I think he's just going to go ahead and do this for Forbidden Ritual to fill up the board. He knows that the only thing that can punish that is the single copy of Maelstrom Portal that's left in Hot Meowth's deck as AoE.
Yep, this is just playing the odds here from Tare. Excellent recognition of the situation. He knows that his hand is a little bit weak right now, so he has to take this small risk to make sure that he seeks initiative on the board. And I have really been impressed by the way Tare has turned his performance around a little bit from prelims, honestly, because I think it's his experience showing through, honestly. His superior ability to cope with these high-pressure situations is starting to show, because at the preliminary, in a slightly more casual environment, we saw him making some pretty poor mistakes, honestly, in some of the Zoo games specifically. But since he's come here to the studios, the pressure of the lights has honestly just seemed to make him play even better.
It's kind of funny, because Tare has played the game for a very long time.
Yeah.
In order to qualify for, you know, the World Championship in 2014, you had to have been playing for quite a bit even before that.
That
so
is true.
And Zoo, even though the cards have changed, even though, you know, some of the strategies have changed, the core mechanics are still intact with the Zoo deck. So I'm sure he's jammed a lot of Zoo games on ladder and tournaments in his sleep, in his dreams. So I'm not really surprised to see his play sort of cleaned up.
Yeah, the Reliquary Seeker is going to have an impact here because of that draw of the Imp Gang boss. Even has enough mana left over to... oh no, he doesn't. This is a full mana usage, so he is going to play the 5-5 here instead of using one of the tempo cards to bust through the 2-3s, but can't blame him. A one-mana 5-5 is usually a pretty solid decision.
He's going to make sure that he gives the maximum chance to hit one of these Feral Spirits before killing the first one so that he can more likely clear the board. And Tare is just in such a huge lead. But Han Miao does pick up Tuskar Totem. It's going to allow him to play Thing from Below for cheaper. But man, Tare has a lot of burst in his hand.
He does, and Hot Meowth is going to use his attacks here to take out the small minions, which is very, very important because of the leverage Tare has from his hand with the Power Overwhelming, which means he's a little bit short, but no longer, because that is Leroy Jenkins that is going to push through. And on the sidebar before this series, TJ, we talked up the importance of the Zoo decks picking up a win. That's exactly what happened.
Yeah, and picking up a win as early as this means that Tare doesn't even have to worry about that. And that's a big deal when you go into a matchup like this and you feel like you get your weakest matchup out of the way. Mm-hmm. And he got a pretty good matchup with the Shaman, so not too bad of a start for Tare. 1-0 in the grand finals. So we're going to move into game number two. Just a moment, right after this. Welcome back, everybody, to the finals. The America Summer Championship. Tare is up 1-0 in the series. And one thing that I was very interested by going into this matchup was their difference in bans and the respect they have for some of these odd choices. Hot Meowth went ahead and banned Tare's mid-range Shaman.
Yep.
And Tare went ahead and banned the sort of removal control warrior of Hot Meowth. Mm-hmm. What do you think of that, Subtle?
I mean, I said that in a lot of these matchups, I would rather have the removal-based warrior in our pre-finals analysis, so I can understand the respect for it. Part of the reason why people have started using that kind of Yogg-Saron spell-heavy list is because it's a little bit more effective in some of these weak matchups, like the Hunter decks that we see here. But Tare in particular, you know, if Hot Meowth is the guy that's brought the slightly unusual Zoo deck to this tournament, Tare is the guy that has brought the slightly unusual Hunter deck to this tournament, because he is playing Cloaked Huntress with exactly two secrets in his deck. He's also playing Princess Huoran as a 5-drop.
It's really interesting. There was players for a while that attempted to make things happen with Nazoth, because just the natural minions that are strong that you play in Hunter nowadays are Death Rattles. You know, Infested Wolf, Savannah High Main, Kindly Grandmother, all of those are fantastic. And that's why you play Barnes, because you're looking for those.
Yep.
So Princess Huoran makes sense. The other ones, I don't know. It's bizarre, but right now, Tare is the one asking the questions.
He is indeed, and we saw this very similar scenario come up in a Hunter Mirror previously, where Huffer was rolled and there was no answer to it. The Huffer got to connect to face twice, and that just created so much initiative for the Hunter player that had rolled the Huffer, to the point where, you know, they're basically just backing up that damage with hero powers and cards from hand every turn, and the defending Hunter at that point is just forced to trade into every single minion and just kind of loses through inevitability here. So Hot Meowth is going to have to find a way to build a platform that he can use to make a counter swing here at some point. He can't just sit around, you know, developing minions on the board. He has to look for a big tempo turn to capitalize and start putting the pressure back the other way.
It's a big deal for these players, not only because it's a mirror matchup and, you know, the fact that Tari has already a 1-0 lead, and winning a mirror matchup would be a big deal for his matchups across the board, but also Hot Meowth is the Hunter Expert. The Data Reaper report for Vicious Syndicate. What would this do for his reputation if he went into a mirror matchup in the finals of a tournament and lost to a guy with a weird Hunter deck?
Oh, the people who judge games of Hearthstone on a one-game sample size would just never let him live it down, TJ. Unforgivable.
They would not. He's going to lose his job.
Interesting. What do you think about this? He played a freezing trap here, and then he chose to take out the larger minion, leaving the cheaper minion to potentially get frozen. What are the reasons for this, TJ?
Well, he's hedging against sort of a way for Hot Meowth to like charge into it or something like that. Also, Houndmaster. So if he leaves the huge toad up, and Hot Meowth is able to kill the Huffer and develop another minion that's weaker, that can trade in to the freezing trap, then he's going to be in a lot worse position than he would otherwise be. Huffer would trade into whatever gets Houndmastered, but it's mostly for that.
Squire goes down. The three dogs get to take down the Houndmastered Fiery Bat, and I think there is only one place this Huffer's going. That is downtown. That is a 12 damage Huffer, TJ.
Oh, yeah. And he's got Kill Command. He's got Quick Shot to back it up.
Like, what do you want in your hand after your three drop has just connected for 12? Well, a big old pile of damage, please. That's what we got.
Yeah, and trading in a 4-3. Well, I guess he picks up the quick shot, which is actually really good. But that Houndmaster is looking lonely. And oh my goodness. Ooh. That's rough.
He would love one of these knives to connect with the Misha. It does not, so he's going to use the kill command instead of the quick shot to push through. But that's not the end of the world, actually, because he now has the chance to push for more damage if he needs it by potentially getting a draw off that quick shot. Even gets him closer to exactly that card, Call of the Wild, if the game lasts long enough for him to need that. But right now, it's not looking like it will.
No. He does. I don't think he even knows what trap this is because he hasn't even checked. I mean, he can sort of guess that it's freezing trap. Well, no, he knows it's freezing trap because those are the only two traps in the deck. Mm-hmm. One was golden, so it was throwing me off. Who puts one golden and one? Okay. But yeah,
that's a fight for another day, TJ.
Yeah. But he has to proc this because he's rolling into Call of the Wild turn, and he needs that five damage from that Charge Huffer, and he needs that five damage from the. Well, actually, no. Actually, maybe it's better to not attack.
Yeah, and as a...
Wait a second.
As a byproduct of that attack, the freezing trap was able to be played, which means that the quick shot actually gets a
draw. Okay, so it's better to not attack because the Houndmaster and the Huffer are going to be the same amount of damage with Leok. They're both attacking next turn. And if Huffer gets freezing trapped, you can actually play it again and charge it again.
But
maybe
that is true.
Maybe the taunt is also... relevant there, but it's cheaper to play the Huffer.
I think the important turn to question as well is his decision to not proc the freezing trap on the previous turn as well, where he just left the Houndmaster on the board.
Just didn't do anything.
It's very, very strange. But yep, Hot Meowth definitely feeling the pressure right now. Tare looking like the veteran he is. He is at a comfortable lead now, and Hot Meowth is going to have to find some way as the underdog here fight his way back in.
Yeah, it seems like Tare definitely has a leg up right now. We'll see what happens in the game number 3 right after this. Tare up 2-0 in the America's Summer Championship Finals. Just 2 more games, and he's got himself a repeat chance at the World Championship at BlizzCon. And Hot Meowth had a lot of confidence in himself, and not many other people had confidence in him, especially after looking at both these guys' deck lists. Nobody was really afraid of him coming into some of these matches. So cool to see them both make it this far, but that's a somber look from Hot Meowth.
It really is, and this is the matchup he wanted as well. You know, I was doing the player room a little bit before this Grand Finals, and Hot Meowth said that he wanted Tare to win. He did not want to face that control-heavy lineup of Roof Trellin because it felt like it picked apart a lot of his deck. So this is what he wanted, so he is going to need to make sure that he has what it takes to capitalize on that advantage from his perspective and fight his way back in.
A lot of players are under the impression that the Hunter is pretty favored against the Control Warrior, but this is probably one of the Control Warrior lists that can do a little bit better. because you do have proactive stuff, and you know, maybe the removal warrior can get to that late game a little bit more consistently. But if you curb out with C'Thun minions, you can win this matchup. But generally across the board, Hunter should just beat Control Warrior.
Definitely true. But that pickup of the Beckoner of Evil, good old River Crocolisk on curve, is actually a big deal here to be able to contest the board. Because now with the bash, he's able to remove this board. Proper sequencing, trying to tank the one damage on his 2-3, doesn't get rewarded for it, but on average save himself half a damage there by sequencing with the bash first.
Yep. So I feel like the Cycle C'Thun came around when Hunter was not very good. And the Cycle C'Thun was meant to sort of target the very fast decks because you just remove everything.
Yes.
But C'Thun's Chosen is really, really good. It contests a lot of these mid-range Hunter minions very well. So if you curve out with C'Thun Warrior, sometimes it can feel okay. You don't necessarily need all of that removal, and some of it doesn't even line up that well.
Yeah, C'Thun's Chosen against classes that can't do one damage easily is just such an obnoxious minion. You know, when the C'Thun cultists started getting revealed prior to the Whispers of the Old Gods set, I was like, well, you know, most of these are just kind of vanilla arena minions. Is that going to be good enough? And then I saw C'Thun's Chosen, I was like, okay, that thing is pretty obnoxious against a lot of classes. Like, I can see this working. So I think that minion in particular is part of the reason why C'Thun decks have been successful over the last few months. And it's doing good work here.
Yeah, but one thing Warrior has traditionally struggled to deal with is just Savannah High Main. You know, they can deal with the first body usually relatively easily with Execute or Shield Slam if they have enough armor built up. But the 2-2s will stick around. They lack a little bit of that sort of targeted removal on small stuff, especially without sort of, you know, the extra whirlwind effects. You can't, like, double Ravage Ghoul to clean that stuff up. But Teray has sort of stabilized a little bit on the board in the early game. But that, will he be able to deal with the high main? That's the big question.
And that was not an obvious decision from Hot Meowth on the previous turn either. He chose to use a kill command to remove the minion instead of the quick shot, which is not only just a question of mana efficiency, but also signals his intentions to try and draw a card with that quick shot to make sure that he has the gas to keep going against the warrior. But alongside Savannah High Main, you know what else is a pretty solid card against warrior? And in fact, against the other eight classes also playable in the game, Hearthstone?
Call of the Wild.
Correct.
Call of the Wild is the thing that you always know is going to come on turn 8. It's one of those cards where it's actually pretty likely that it gets there by turn 8. You have two copies of it in your deck.
Yep.
Turn 8 is pretty far into the game, so you can usually expect your opponent to have it, which means you can try and play around. You can make your board as most resilient to Call of the Wild as you can. And it can still destroy you.
Yeah, I mean, not only can you, but you absolutely do. Because, you know, Call of the Wild, the discrepancy in power level between Call of the Wild and an average card in the Hunter deck is so high that, you know, rarely in Hearthstone is it right to think so linear about a play. It's like, I'm going to specifically just play around X card here. But with Call of the Wild, the effect is so much more powerful than anything else the Hunter can do that that's just often the only consideration you really need to bring into your mind.
It's very true. And Tare, he has kept a decent position on the board, but he's very far behind in resources. And he's really going to need some help from the top of his deck. He's going to need C'Thun, effectively, is what he's going to need. And even then, it might be tough for him to sustain through all this burst, plus Call the Wild, plus Burn to back it up.
Yep.
That's what you want. Keep these precious minions alive.
And that is a 7 damage Call of the Wild, 5 from the Huffer, adding 2 more to the existing 1-1s on the board. And Tarai just has no activator for that Shield Slam here to be able to do anything relevant. He can use it to take out the Huffer if he wants to, but then that would be his entire turn, essentially. He'd be developing a War Axe alongside that. But, you know, this is exactly what Hunter does. You know, Hot Meowth, of course, does work for the Vicious Syndicate Data Reaper, and if you look at that, you know, a few months ago when C'Thun Warrior was popular and Control Warriors were popular, it was one of the most lopsided matchups on that entire report.
Yes, it was. And it still tends to be. You know, you have to sort of have it looks nice when you sort of curve out perfectly with C'Thun minions, and your opponent misses Call of the Wild on 8 and misses High Main on 6.
Yeah.
But, you know, those are pretty late game cards that the Hunter is going to definitely strive to have at that point in the game. So you can tell just how much Tare is struggling to even just stabilize. And that is just going to be it, the Eagle Horn Bow, will be enough damage to finish off the game. And Hamiao puts himself on the board, brings the series to 2-1.
Yeah, hugely important win for him. I think, you know, Tare as the veteran here, as the player with more comfort, more experience in this situation. If it did start to snowball, Hot Meowth could potentially start doubting himself. That's a huge win just for the mental side of the game to bring himself back into this series.
Yeah, probably one of the reasons why he left it up, especially with mid-range Shaman being so strong across the board. He was confident that if he could get that good matchup against the Warrior, he could take it out and capitalize a little bit. But series now 2-1, still in favor of Tare, and we're going to get into game number 4 right after this. Tare versus Hot Meowth, the finals of the America's Summer Championship. It's now 2-1 in favor of Tare. But Hot Meowth putting himself back on the board, and he's got his Fast and Furious decks still remaining, with his Zoo, his Druid, and his Aggro Shaman.
Yeah, and he picked up a win with the Hunter, and of course there's no such thing as a bad win, but there are unimportant wins, and that mid-range Hunter felt like a deck that was going to pick up a win before the end of this series regardless. So I don't think it's a huge impact to him in the overall texture, but as I mentioned before we went to the quick commercial, it is a huge deal in terms of the mental side and his comfort in that hot seat right now, staring across the table at a man with greater experience than him.
Yeah, I mean, he has started off both of his matches so far in the championship weekend with 3-0 starts. Mm-hmm. So going down 0-2 is not a feeling that he's used to on a big stage. He's always been sort of the one in the driver's seat. So getting that win is incredibly important, like you mentioned, for his psyche. But now moving into the Aggressive Shaman versus C'Thun Warrior. This one is a little bit tough because Aggressive Shaman is, they're going to get on the board early, and they're going to get on the board early fast.
Yep.
And C'Thun Warrior doesn't necessarily have as many removal tools. They just sort of rely on curving out with minions.
Right. There is unanswered Flame Tongue here, which is one of the ways that the Aggro Shaman can make a big dent in this matchup and really start to snowball. But just take a look at Tare's hand right now. He has the 2+2+2 buffs for C'Thun, one that he played already, and now the Disciple of C'Thun follow-up. And then he has the Twin Emperor of Eklor for the taunts. He has the Ancient Shield Bearer for gain 10. And he has the eventual clock in his hand of C'Thun itself. So this is a job that Hot Meowth is going to have to get done very quickly, or he is just going to run into way too powerful defensive options from Tare.
He does have a pretty decent hand to do that with great early minions and following that up with a Doomhammer. This is the order that you sort of want to draw your stuff. You want minions first. You want the consistent damage second. You want the burn third. And it seems like that's the way this is going. But, I mean, Tare, if he manages to get to, like you mentioned, sort of that mid-game where he can stabilize with those 7 drops and then get to turn 10 where he can drop the C'Thun and solidify the game, then Hot Meowth's going to be in some trouble.
Yeah, right now there is just that second copy of Flame Tongue now just causing an incredible amount of havoc on the board. I mean, Tare is having to consider here whether it's worth him executing it, and it looks like he's just going to go for the tempo Brand play here, basically forcing Brand to be respected as a 2-4 taunt from his opponent and moving forward from there. But having held onto the coin here as well is now a very big deal because he can use the next turn to develop his Disciple of C'Thun, and then his following turn will be a 6-mana turn where he can go straight into one of those big 7 drops.
But he has taken a lot of damage. And what is he actually getting rid of with that Disciple of C'Thun? He might have to execute the Flame Tongue Totem.
I mean, I wondered whether this was the play last turn. I just didn't really see what the upside of Bran was going to be. You know, sometimes you can play a Bran, hope your opponent is going to ignore it, and then you get a big tempo play with the Disciple of C'Thun, for example. But there was just such efficient trades already presented on the board. That thing was never going to live. So it seemed like a wasted turn to an extent from Tare. But now, as you said, the execute comes down. Hot Meowth is going to push through as much damage as he can. He's going to get the slightly sad news that there are many, many defensive options in hand for Tare, but there are no answers to the board right now, and the board is out of control for Hot Meowth.
Tare, this is sort of the hand that you want when you're talking about C'Thun Warrior versus any sort of aggressive matchup. You're like, well, as long as I have my activators early, all I want is my 7 drops to my C'Thun. But not when your opponent really has a board like this. There is a likelihood that whatever Tare plays is just going to get answered. And
yeah,
he doesn't know what's in hand. A Lava Burst plus like 2 trades for minions will be enough to get through these 2 4-6s. And if even though you're playing Ancient Shield Bearer, if you're gaining 10, but your opponent has 10 power on the board, you're really not doing much of anything because you're not furthering your chance to win in the match.
Yeah, I like the sequencing here. Got leading with the Vetclaw, following up with the Shieldbearer afterwards because he needs the board to be addressed here. And the 4-6 taunts will at least tank some of these minions off the board, at least in Tare's optimistic world here. But yeah, as you said, it feels like he's had a really powerful draw, but the missing component, honestly, has been the Fiery War Axe. If he'd have had a Fiery War Axe to go along with some of this, the board wouldn't have snowballed anywhere close to what you can see here. And then these big power minions would have been able to just lock up the late game.
Hot Meowth making some really solid trades, and this is sort of the situation that I talked about. There's 10 power on the board.
Yep.
So healing for 10 really doesn't do anything. And now all Hot Meowth needs is 2 damage from the top of his deck to make that 16. And ooh. So he actually had the chance to trade Argent Squire and Totem Golem instead of Tunnel Trog last turn and leave the Tunnel Trog alive.
He did.
So I don't really, the 4 health is actually sometimes a really important benchmark than the 3 health, but it's hidden behind Feral Spirits.
Yep.
And you know that your opponent, if they play something that has to kill it, so maybe a little bit of an error, I'm not sure if it really matters, but it could in the overall scheme of things. That would have been lethal if he had saved that, because he would have pushed the exact same amount of damage last turn.
Yeah, and we saw this exact draw, Flame Wreath Faceless being lethal because of the presence of a Tunnel Trog in the previous series, and obviously was not a sticking point in Hot Meowth's mind. So, you know, Tare here, just not good enough to gain another 10 life here. It's just not going to be good enough with the addition of that 7-7 to the board. It's like Tare is going to go with it anyway, but again, he's curved out his C'Thun minions this game. He's played a 4-6, 2 4-6 taunts on curve. He's gained 20 life, and still, the oppressive aggression of Aggro Shaman has just beaten through him and has left him a bloody beaten pulp on the ground.
You need a swing turn in that matchup. You need a turn where you clear the entire board, and then you move, and then you move forward with your health gain or your taunting up. And he just wasn't able to get that. You need like brawl into those minions, or you need revenge into those minions, and those options are limited when you're running sort of that C'Thun deck because you have a lot of spots for minions to try and activate that C'Thun. And even though he had a really good curve, wasn't able to pull it out, and it's now tied up 2-2. So we got ourselves a series. And you can see the decks remaining. Hot Meowth with Druid and Zoo Warlock remaining, and Tare with the C'Thun Warrior and the Druid remaining. So Hot Meowth with his sort of liability deck, and Tare, the C'Thun Warrior, is sort of looking like the liability deck for him.
Yeah, it's been a thing of people choosing to bring old school legacy decks to this tournament. Honestly, has been a recurring theme. We've seen players bringing Freeze Mage because it's a deck that's not too common in the meta these days, but some of these players have a strong attachment to it. You spoke about Tare, connecting with this C'Thun Warrior, and he bringing it because of a deck that he liked. And of course, Roof Trellin, probably the biggest example of this, just bringing the lineup that he likes and it just not being successful for him in the end. So the question has to be begged: is this C'Thun Warrior going to be good enough here for Tare, with most people moving on to other warrior decks, or if C'Thun, then the cycle heavy C'Thun deck?
Indeed, and the cycle C'Thun probably better in a lot of situations against this matchup, but Tare has a fantastic opening hand with Fiery War Axe removal, Ravaging Ghoul, and Brawl. Those are all the tools that you want just at some point in the game against Zoo Warlock, and he has them all in his opening.
Yeah, and that Fiery War Axe is huge because the Demon Fire is in hand right now, which meant if that Flaming was to go unanswered, then Demon Fire would start to make a mess of that Warrior's life total very quickly. But yeah, this Fiery War Axe was the missing component in the previous matchup for me. If he'd have had that early War Axe, the board wouldn't have snowballed anywhere near what it did, and those two Shield Bearers would have just been able to stabilize much, much stronger. So the War Axe pickup is incredibly important here.
A little bit of a tough choice from Hot Meowth in that situation. Two pretty poor minions, and couple that with a Power Overwhelming in a hand that really is already chock full of spells. So he goes with the Power Overwhelming just because it's the only option that sort of he can do anything with. And now, without minions on the board, facing down a Warrior on turn 3 that already has control of the board, and a second Fiery War Axe is drawn.
Yeah, this is just going to be a very, very fast downward spiral here unless Hot Meowth is able to put something spectacular together because, as you said, TJ, there's just everything that Tare needs. That second Fiery War Axe, just the icing on the cake, means that he gets to have a War Axe equipped throughout, you know, the opening four turns of the game. And there's just, Zhu is just unable to develop a board against this. And if Zhu can't get a minion to stick, Zhu is just never going to win a game of Hearthstone.
100% reliant on the board, and even both Ravaging Ghouls. So in this situation, Tare can feel comfortable going with a Ravaging Ghoul to remove this instead of, say, a Disciple of C'Thun, because he knows that he has a second one to back it up. He also knows that a Hot Meowth doesn't run the Forbidden Ritual.
Yeah.
So that means he has a little bit more room to use these more liberally in the early parts of the game.
Yeah, it was often the case in this matchup that almost every single turn, Ravaging Ghoul feels like it's powerful when you're playing pretty much any type of warrior deck against Zhu. But in the past, you would always have to consider, you know, does it give me enough of an advantage here to mitigate the potential risk of my opponent just filling the board with Forbidden Ritual later? But no such concern with both Ravaging Ghouls in hand and the Forbidden Rituals not being there, as you mentioned. And this is just Zhu getting tempoed out on by a C'Thun warrior, just getting beaten down by control minions.
How often do you see this? And he goes into turn seven with Twin Emperor Veklor. I mean, he's just going to win the game next turn. He's got 8 plus 5. He's got 13 power on the board plus a bash in his hand. He's got way more than enough damage to close this one out. And Hot Meowth never had control of the board this game. Not once. In a Zhu versus Warrior matchup, he literally did not have the initiative on board the entire game.
Yep, Tare stares across the desk into Hot Meowth's eyes and says, "Who is the aggro now? I just killed you on turn 7 with my control deck." And that is just a huge blowout. Like, C'Thun Warrior just effective, you know, a concede on turn 7, you know, effective lethal on turn 7. Never thought I'd see it, but just way too powerful an opening. Zhu just not able to climb onto the board. And he did draw a lot of those situational cards, you know, the Demon Fires, the Lance Carriers. I'm not for a second going to say that, you know, more standard Zhu cards would have had an impact on that game, because that was just a crushing from the Warrior.
It was tough. It was tough. Hot Meowth, though, has to sort of forget about that game. We're starting to get down to the wire now. Tare is on match point for the remainder of this series. He only has Druid left in his lineup, which has, you know, been touted as sort of the most consistent decks in a lot of these lineups, maybe with an exception for Aggro Shaman, which has been banned away a lot of the time for these players. So it's looking good for Tare. Can Hot Meowth find a win with that Zhu Warlock that he has struggled with at points throughout the weekend?
Yeah, I mean, if there's one deck that possibly the Demon Fire strategy is much more powerful against, it is arguably Druid, because an effective 3-5 on turn 2, that's just not something that Druid is ever going to be able to interact with. So he'll be looking for one of those power curves here, but Tare himself has picked up Living Roots on turn 1, which is a very big deal. Has the Fandral early as well, just missing some mana acceleration, and he will be taking deep breaths here, making sure all his play is considered and optimal, because he is on the hill of history here, repeat history, matching the achievements of Kranich and Tice so far.
Yeah, he would be the second player of the 2016 season, or the 2016 tour, to qualify for his second BlizzCon, which would be really impressive for him, as well as just the overall, you know, player pool in 2016. But, you know, it comes down to this. It's kind of crazy when you think about it. If you're in Tare's spot, you work almost an entire year, or at least an entire season.
Yep.
And it comes down to one game of Hearthstone. You have to win one game of Hearthstone. And so definitely hyper-focused, trying to make sure he's got the right place. Tare, though, he's a fast player regardless. He's an experienced player. He's going to trust in his instincts.
Yeah, and I honestly don't mind seeing that, as long as your play backs it up. I saw, you know, Casey get a lot of criticism for his play in one of the prelims. He's playing incredibly fast, but, you know, if that's just your natural style and you're used to playing like that, then if that's what it takes for you to feel comfortable to just maintain your natural rhythm, I'm okay with it.
All right, well, Tare does have a swipe to answer this Flame Imp, and he's rolling into Fandral plus Raven Idol. See, Hot Meowth really needs... Wow, okay. A snap call in the Argent Squire. Defender of Argus is a tough card to play a lot of times in the matchup. Maybe he's just thinking that's going to get discarded, and he's on the aggressive plan this game.
Yeah, it seems valid. Raven Idol with Fandral, a fantastic value play, but you know, nothing in terms of affecting the board here with tempo, and he's just going to pick up a third swipe, which, yeah, I mean, why not? Can't complain, but this Doomguard is going to come down and rock Tare's world here with the new addition of the Karazhan card. The Malkazar's Imp, he cycles those two cards out of his deck, and this is exactly why this strategy is so powerful, because the Doomguards, the Soulfires, those power cards in your deck, they are so strong. You want to draw them every game, and this cycle tech with the Malkazar's Imp allows you to do that much more consistently. Doomguard number one comes down, or goes down, sorry. Doomguard number two is right behind it.
Yeah, Tare, he's able to clear the board, but he's at 13 health. That's so low. If Hot Meowth picks up a one drop to supplement this Doomguard, he doesn't. So, you know, that's a little bit of a breath of fresh air for Tare, but not much because he's at eight.
It's not going to be good enough, and Tare staring at this Doomguard with no hope in sight of removing it right now. Gadgetzan Moonfire could draw him a card, but with one mana remaining, there is no possible prospect of removing that Doomguard either. Even if he was to draw an Innovate, I don't think there's a particular path. Maybe second Raven Idol off an Innovate, and then, then you pick up a Naturalize off the Raven Idol. I mean, these are the dream worlds that he's having to fish for here, because he is seeing his first shot at Repeat BlizzCon history melting away in front of him right now, and he might have to go down to game seven.
Yeah, he might just go full out ramp to try and go into 10 mana Witch turn.
I buy it.
Which means he's searching for Yogg-Saron. He's also searching for just more mana.
One
to
one
be
more
able
damage.
To play some of these spells.
That's
one more
two damage.
Oh,
that
is
four more. Hot Meowth squares this up, and although this series has seemed incredibly quick, it's going all the way to game number seven. Couldn't ask for more in our grand finals to decide not only the America's champion, but the next recipient of a spot at BlizzCon.
And it comes down to Druid versus Druid. The summer season has sort of been the era of Druid, at least for the 2016 tour. Sort of its rise to power, its evolution of the sort of lineups that it's brought with Token Druid and eventually going off to the Malagos Druid. And now it comes down to this.
It certainly does. And it's going to come down to the wire. Honestly, this matchup is often decided first and foremost. The first check is, you know, who has tempo and initiative come around turn 5 to 6 of the game, or, you know, the five to six mana period of the game. Let's not call it a turn. And then at that point, it becomes very, very difficult for the other druid player to fight back from there, unless Yogg. And that is the big asterisk on this mirror match, is that no matter how dominant a position you can be in, there is always that final equalizer.
Yeah, both decks are consistent. Both decks have a lot of ramp and a lot of removal, which means if one player doesn't get a significant advantage around that mid-range mark, like you talked about, then it will go very late in the match. And right now I see a Wild Growth in Hot Meow's hand, so right now that sort of gives him a little bit of an edge. We'll see what Tare picks up, and I don't know if that's a hand that I want to ride on in the final game of a championship. I'm Tare.
It is really not looking good. Tare is going to have a couple of draws here to try and find himself some ramp. Raven Idol is a fine card too, because that gives him essentially a rebuy to pick up a mana acceleration card. But fighting this battle in the Druid Mirror, where one player has Wild Growth and one player doesn't, is extremely one-sided. If you don't believe me, ask Admirable. He will be happy to talk about it at length anytime that you like.
He's standing over on the side of the stage, smiling as well. But that's not a good follow-up hand for Hot Meowth. He needs a little bit more substance. He needs minions. He needs something to just place onto the board.
How about an Emperor Thorsan
is about as good as it gets in that situation. He's not producing the most important cards in the list, but Living Roots can be important because it can be coupled with Malagos. Swipe can be important because it can be coupled with, you know, any of your spell power minions, including Malagos with Innervate. So Tare does pick up an Innervate for himself too, so he could match that Emperor Thorsan with his Emperor Thorsan.
And his Emperor Thorsan is insane because it is discounting Fandral plus double Wrath, which is potentially good enough to swing him back into this game after allowing his opponent to have a two-turn Emperor. So that Innovate draw, I said he'd have a couple of draws to find himself some mana acceleration, perhaps one turn later than he would have liked it, but possibly still good enough to bring him back into this hugely important Game 7.
Yeah, we'll see though, because Hot Meow does have ways to deal with the Emperor Thor's hand. He's got Feral Rage plus a hero power, which would kill it cleanly, give him another turn of discount, which would also make Azure Drake plus Swipe, you know, a really cheap combination. It'd be 6 mana total. And Tari actually doesn't have a way to deal with the Emperor Thor's hand this turn unless he goes with double Wrath. And that
doesn't.
In that case, he has to forego the Fandral plus his Wrath. He could also, no, that is the only way. He could Swipe plus Wrath for one, I suppose, to try and keep one around. Mm-hmm. Which might even be a better play.
Yeah, I mean, there's also a possibility at this point to just say, you know what, the damage of that Emperor is kind of done at this point. Like, how much worse is the third discount on your three-card hand going to be? And I'm going to hold on to some of these powerful cards like Wrath and use them in a more advantageous situation for me later with the Fandral. But the development of Drake being the follow-up here from Hot Meowth is going to be looking pretty rosy for Tare. This is his chance. This is his tempo swing. Fandral Staghelm plus Wrath for 4 and draw a card. Now he has the value play of Raven Idol as well to pull him ahead on resources as well as tempo.
And he picks up a Nourish also. So Tare has managed to get through this early game and...
Sick.
Wow. Okay, well, that's about the most inconsequential Raven Idol for a minion I've ever seen. The Blackwater Pirate.
Quick check, TJ. Was there an Eater of Secrets in that Discover?
No.
Okay, just wanted to be sure.
0 Eater of Secrets are picked up. But Hot Meowth does pick up Moonglade Portal, which gives him something to sort of play onto this board. But he realizes that Fandral is much too threatening.
Yep.
That's a lot of resources that are having to be used.
Okay. I mean, Gadgetzan is a tool that he can use here to start climbing his way back into this game. He does have a decent cycle turn available to him next turn, with other cheap spells still remaining in the deck that he can start to daisy chain to dig a long way through his deck. He does also still have the mana advantage, remember, in this game. So if he can fight his way back, and that is a poor minion coming out.
That's perfect for Hot Meowth because yeah, it lines up with the
right.
3 damage that he has in his hand. That's insane.
Look at this turn. Living Roots
comes
down.
If he picks up an Innervate, he can Innervate out the Arcane Giant.
He can. That is very true. But Malagos drawn instead after he's just used the Moonfire. But most importantly, that has cycled him a little way through his deck. It's played his spells. You can see with the Arcane Giant here, he's played 8 spells this game, which is a reasonable Yogg. It is a passable Yogg. And he does have some heavy hitters in his hand to back this up. So this game, after the initial blowout from Hot Meowth, the counter swing from Tare is coming all the way down to the wire now.
And sometimes in this matchup, you can just play Malagos. You know, maybe not in a ladder environment because you're unsure if your opponent runs Mulch. Sometimes it can be a little bit too risky. But if you look at a lot of Malagos lists nowadays, and if you look at Tare's list, just run Mulch.
Nope.
So how is he going to deal with a 4/12 that's just smacked onto an empty board? It's nearly impossible unless you were given like a Mulch from Raven Idol or a Naturalize from Raven Idol. So.
Yep, and Hot Meowth will know, and I think I'm correct in saying this, that none of the cards in Tare's hand are Raven Idol spells right now. They've been used, so he will be safe from Mulch. Normally, the response to...
Power of the Wild.
Oh, the Power of the Wild, you're right. Yeah, you're absolutely right.
So he might be afraid that it's Mulch. He hasn't seen the Raven Idol spell just yet. So yeah, he's not gonna slam it. It's usually only good on the sort of like an empty board. You don't want to give your opponent really... Oh my! A Cairn from Moonglade Portal. That's much better than just a card shoot.
It is.
That's much better than just about most 6 drops that you could possibly think of.
Your argument checks out, TJ. I agree with your assessment. Cairn Bloodhoof, the vastly superior outcome to the Moonglade Portal here. Tare now again finds himself a long way behind. And I don't know, buddy. I don't know if Blackwater Pirate quite has what it takes to come back onto this board.
Well, Sol, if he draws any weapons, they're going to cost 2 less.
TJ, you know how you said to me that Shatter would not have an impact on the game? I'm pretty sure Blackwater Pirate is not going to have an impact on this game.
Yeah. And he's going to try and make sort of the best play that he can, and that's going to be it's going to be sort of a Yogg plan here. He's going to go with the Moonfire to clear off this Arcane Giant so he can save himself 8 life going into these next turns. And, I mean, he's got to dodge quite a bit of damage, though, because he's still got another turn before he can even play Yogg-Saron.
And now, crucially, the Raven Idol card has been used. So now Hot Meowth knows that the Raven Idol card is not in hand for Tare. Now he can feel free to develop that Malagos onto the board safely, because, as you said, the only other real answer to it is a Yogg turn from your opponent. He's a little bit away from that Yogg, so I love to see the Malagos come down here, because next turn he has Nourish to try and pick up some spells to leverage with that spell damage. Tare is in a huge mess here.
Yeah, I mean, at this stage, it's basically just use all of your spells and hope for the best. Hot Meowth has been through a lot of his burn so far in this game. He's been through, like, Living Roots, he's been through a Moonfire, he's been through Swipes. So there isn't, you know, too many left. And Arcane Giant is actually going to be a decent pickup because he could just play it for free this turn and effectively empty his hand. He could ensure that his Yogg-Saron will have the most possible spells.
Yep, so there'll be 11 right now if he plays all the spells alongside it. Then he will be at a 15-spell Yogg-Saron, which is more than enough to swing even the most bleak of situations back in your favor. From Hot Meow's perspective, he has the dream available to him if he wants it, TJ. You've had experience with this recently. The Malagos plus Yogg turn on the same board is at his disposal if he wants it.
It is scary. There aren't many board effects that synergize with Yogg-Saron, but Spell Power is one of them. So if you have, say, an Azure Drake or a Blood Mage Thalanos, or perhaps a Malagos, all of the spells that Yogg casts gain that spell damage effect. So, yeah. We're talking about 8 damage Hellfires. We're talking about 15 damage Pyroblasts. We're talking about some scary stuff.
But from Hot Meow's perspective here, he can easily look at this turn from Tare and make a read that this is a Yogg setup from Tare. So he may just be, you know, a little bit on the plan of just allowing his opponent to try and take their Yogg out here and then still having his own Yogg-Saron available for the counter swing if he needs it. And that is a 11-spell Yogg on Arcane Giant's convenient. Yeah. There's 11-spell Yogg from Hot Meowth of his own available to him on the follow-up if he wants to go for it.
But there's a big thing here, and this is one of those turns where if you think that your opponent's going to play Yogg-Saron, you might not want to overload on the board too much.
Agreed.
Especially if you have the resource advantage, and especially if you know that it's coming, then that's out of the way, so you can feel free to flood the board after that.
Yep.
So I think going with sort of a halfway point here and still developing a little bit, but not going too all in on this board is going to be the right call for Hot Meowth in case something crazy happens.
Yeah, so I mean, he is going to go ahead and develop his Arcane Giant here and just make the situation as awkward as possible. This is the counter argument, is just to try and present a board that is too much for a Yogg-Saron to reasonably deal with. But unless something spectacular is drawn here from Tare, it's going to be a Yogg-Saron turn. He's going to fire the Moonfire first, and this is it. Center stage, all eyes on you, buddy. Show us what you've got.
All right. Well, I believe this is 14 spells. Starts off well. That's a Flame Lance. Shadow Strike, if that's onto the Cairn, nope. Kills off his own Yogg and a Moonfire. 2 Moonfires in one turn, but not necessarily the most impactful. Healing Touch, regardless, this one won't be that great, but it goes onto his face. Vanish.
Vanish is huge. That is a clunky 9 mana card now back in the hand of Hot Meowth. If Tare can find some way to generate board of his own here through initiative spells that stand against darkness, Feral Spirits, Call of the Wild, of course, is the dream. He might be able to gain the initiative that he needs. Nope. No such thing. Does get a head crack back.
He's got a head crack. Oh, man, at the end of the day. But Tare doesn't really have much left in his deck. He does have Malagos remaining, plus a couple of spells with the Living Roots, but no Emperor Thorsand to reduce those. I believe he doesn't have any Innervates left either, so there's no way that he can use those for spell unless Malagos sticks onto the board for a turn. So Hot Meowth is just going to load up the board again and, you know, just say go.
Yeah, Meowth gets the news that secret number 1 was Mirror Entity, which of course could have been disastrous if he'd have chosen to develop one of his more powerful minions. So just goes a little bit wide on the board. You made this point on the previous turns, TJ. With Yogg gone, with Swipes gone, with so many removal cards already used, Hot Meowth is free to develop as he sees fit now.
So this is tough. Soul of the Forest and Wisps of the Old Gods both are interesting because he has double Living Roots in his hand, both of which he knows he can't necessarily combo with Malygos at the same time for the damage unless Malygos sticks for a turn without the innervates.
Yep.
So he could play double Living Roots and then Soul of the Forest to make 4 1/1s plus, you know, the Death Rattle effect. Or he could just go with 7 1/1s with the Wisps.
Or he could play double Living Roots and Wisps of the Old Gods to buff to make a bunch of 3/3s.
Yeah.
The possibilities are endless.
So the double Living Roots plus Wisps of the Old Gods is sort of the same amount of power, just all at once instead of from the Death Rattle.
Yep.
And he's trying to think back to see if he sees swipes.
You can understand why this decision is taking so long here from someone who's you mentioned is predominantly a very, very fast player. He understands the importance of that decision that he just made to take the Wisps of the Old Gods. Several viable options here in terms of what his play is, but he needed to address one of the most important decisions of his Hearthstone career, that Raven Idol choice.
Ho, ho.
And that is going to make his choice feel pretty bad.
Yeah, that is rough. He was already in a pretty rough position as it was, and Hotmeow is going to get the news here that it's Vaporize as opposed to Ice Block or Ice Barrier, which were the only two remaining, I believe, that he hadn't checked for. So Tare is in dire straits. I don't even know if there's any card in his deck that can help him at this stage. I mean, a free 8/8 is never hurtful.
Yeah, the last time he drew a 0-mana 8/8, you described it as a decent draw. And yeah, I think that is a fairly good description.
It's pretty decent.
Yeah, it's adequate.
But help me out, still has plenty of gas.
Just get that Hecarite rolling. He's on a clock.
Deal effectively 1 damage every turn if your opponent hero powers. Yeah. Just cancel it out, and it appears right back like magic.
So, swipe, pick up. The 8A on the board is scary. Is it enough? How many other threats does he really need to save his Yogg-Saron to deal with? Hot Meowth has the same stance. He's just going to go. That is a good start. Replace. Oh, never mind. It hit the Yogg.
That is a.
I thought it hit the 2-2.
Oh, man.
I thought it hit the 2-2. Leave me alone.
It was close. I mean, replace a 7-5 without stealth with a 5-5 with stealth.
Yeah.
That's decent. All right, enter the Colosseum. Pretty inconsequential. Brawl, though, this one could be really good or really bad, and it's really good. And that was one of Trey's last threats. Kill Command is actually activated and will deal the 5 damage to the face. And if he needed anything else, Hot Meowth draws 2 more with the Solemn Vigil.
Flare.
Flare, of course. Reveal stealth minions. And that's a pretty good outcome. Not that Hot Meowth needed to even get further ahead, but he did need to find an answer to that Arcane Giant, and he did.
Yep. A decent Yogg from Hot Meowth in the end. Develops himself an 8-5 on the board. That is a huge threat here. Can be removed with the Feral Rage, but that is a huge amount of damage to tank when you have not seen your opponent's Malygos yet. You have and have vanished it back to their hand. I'm sorry. So you know the Malygos is there threatening burst damage if there are spells remaining. So, but there's just no option. You just have to face tank that thing, right? Like, what does gaining 8 do for you? You just leave 8 power on the board.
I mean, that's couldn't be more true. You would leave 8 power on the board. But how does Tare win from here? What does he have left in his deck? He's got Malygos. He's got a single Moonfire.
Yep.
He has no Living Roots. He has no Raven Idol, since he's used both his Raven Idols early on. Mm-hmm. And I think Tare is trying to think of that himself.
He has no Arcane Giants. He's used both of those as well.
Both of his Arcane Giants as well. He doesn't really have any way to generate power.
It's looking rough. I mean, live for another 23 turns, cast Headcrack on each of them, mitigate your opponent's hero power. Doesn't look like a too much of a promising win condition, but it might be all that Tare has here. And the veteran here, that his hopes of the repeat BlizzCon performance are slowly falling away from him. Tare just has all the options he could ever need in hand to push through here.
Malygos is just going to be played onto the board. Yep. No threat. Both Raven Idol's gone. He saw the spell from the last Raven Idol. There's absolutely nothing that could punish him.
Yeah, man. I was thinking about just innovating swipe there. Gadgetzan, Headcrack. I just don't see the card that this can pick up. I think the clock has struck 12 on the Cinderella story here for Tare. He will not be joining the Hall of Fame of Kranich and Tice. It's looking like this one is going to Hot Meowth, and Swipe is going to finish the game. TJ, we have our America's champion.
That is right, Hot Meowth. A great performance on the day. He's going to be the America's summer champion, booking his spot at the World Championship at BlizzCon. He was underestimated all the way through the bracket. He said the caches that didn't predict him. Well, it sucks for them because he's going to win in the end. But we have Frodan standing by on stage for some words with our champion.
We've had hundreds of people enter the summer season, the most desperate season of all, because it's the last spot that they can qualify from the open portion, and you are the summer champion, Hot Meowth. What's going through your head right now?
That was a crazy series. It all came down to Jude versus Jude, and we both played our Yogs. It can go either way. It was a 50-50 matchup against him, because like my line was like almost the same against him. So I was just really happy that I made it.
Absolutely. You made it, man, and you were able to do it with your own style. And, you know, despite the fact that you've been dabbing, you've been tossing out some emotes here and there, you're pretty good at Hearthstone, right?
Yeah, I'm kind of bad manners, but yeah, I'm happy.
That's why we love you. It is my honor to present to you the trophy. Congratulations. I like to present to you the champion of the Americas region for the summer season. It's Hot Meowth from Nevada. Thank you so much, everyone's tuned in. We're gonna have a sidebar analysis as well as a winner's interview. We'll talk a little bit about your strategy and how you broke down the weekend, the edges that you gained. But for now, we're gonna head over to the sidebar with TJ and crew for a breakdown of what we just watched.
So Hot Meowth is the champion at the end of the day, knocking out the previous world champion attendee in Tare. I mean, my name's TJ, I'm joined by Admiral Kor, of course. Admiral, what'd you think of that one? It went all the way to game number seven, came down to an intense Druid Mirror. How'd you think of that grand final?
I mean, you could just kind of feel the emotion coming through both players in this finals. The pace of play was just blistering fast at times. You know, Teray reminded himself to kind of slow down and figure out the right turns. And then coming down to game seven in Druid versus Druid, we saw Emperors on both sides. We saw Moonglade Portals on both sides. We saw Yogg-Saron on both sides. But in the end, when you pit wits and will against luck, it has to be decided by the cards.
Yeah, very high velocity is a big thing. And Cora, going into this one, a lot of players had sort of underestimated Hot Meowth. No, none of the sort of people on the analyst desk predicted him. Nobody really sort of gave him the time of day as far as predicting him to win the whole thing. A lot of people were looking at Dude. You were looking at Topo Pablo. So what do you think of Hot Meowth's performance across the entire bracket and not just in the grand finals?
I think he was certainly very impressive. He had a really clean run in the preliminaries to make it to this tournament, and then he took out some absolutely fantastic players to win the entire tournament. So definitely Tare, not an easy player to defeat, and it did end up going all the way to game seven. So really, what a way to crown a champion. No other way than a really, really exciting Druid Mirror and seven action-packed games. So I think definitely very deserving.
Yeah, he defeated Dude early in the day, which was impressive. And, it was a 4-0 against Dude early in the day. So really impressive stuff. I want to talk about sort of his lineup overall. He had a really interesting strategy. It was sort of like a strategy where he was trying to do a lot of things at once. He was trying to counter the best decks while also being able to be good against the rest of the field. And having some decks that were a little bit inconsistent. Admirable, is this a strategy that we're going to see more of in the future, especially as we, you know, talk about best of seven conquests and the things there? Or do you think this is just something that is a Hot Meowth style of play?
Well, something about the nature of this format is, like, you will have core strategies that come into it. Something that was really interesting was his take on Warrior. You know, we've been seeing Control Warrior be kind of left by the wayside as Dragon Warrior was the most popular deck. Both players in the finals had some form of Control Warrior in their lineup. They both had some form of Zoo. They both had Hunter. That's like a really big thing to think about when you're looking at these lineups. The fact that Dragon Warrior was very dominant, Control Warrior ended up being the best at the end. The Hunters had a lot of variation between them. Maybe there's something going on there between the builds. But I really think a big catalyst to it was kind of just the strength of Hot Meowth's potential draws. I mean, having Malkazar's Imp into Doomguard is a huge swing in the game.
Yeah, it really is. It had some inconsistencies early on in the tournament, but it really did some work in those final two matches, semifinals and finals. So, Cora, there are a lot of great players competing in the World Championship already. We have Amnesiac, we have Handsome Guy, we have Tice, we have Namin. I mean, there's, and across the board, they're all really strong players with a lot of Hearthstone experience. Hot Meowth is coming in as sort of a, maybe a little bit of a newbie. How is he going to stack up in just a few months when we do get to that World Championship?
I mean, Hot Meowth is certainly the underdog, but, you know, when most of the community are players who don't have this experience, don't get to play in competitive tournaments, and especially not at the BlizzCon stage, they love to root for an underdog and somebody who can really represent the every man or woman, the every Hearthstone player. So I think that is definitely going to get him a little bit of attention. But then, of course, we've got those huge names like Tice, Naaman, Dione, all these guys who are on very well-established teams, who have a lot of really dazzling credentials. So Hot Meowth certainly has a lot to live up to. But, you know what, going up against the stack, certainly he's already proven himself.
Yeah, he definitely has proven himself against more experienced players, especially in the finals. And, you know, he does have a lot of experience playing in those open tournaments. But is he going to be able to, Admirable, translate sort of that open tournament experience and sort of this one big LAN that he's won? Is he going to be able to translate that into a 16-player best in the world tournament when we go to the World Championship?
I mean, that's what we have the tournament for, right, is to see the journey that they've come through to get to this point and how it ends up stacking up. You know, Hot Meowth, this was his third preliminary that he had played in, all the locations at the Esports Arena. And he's been taking it pretty seriously while he's there. You know, he obviously likes to have a little bit of fun when he's playing the game. You know, obviously frustration can get to you at times. But this wasn't like a one-and-off thing for Hot Meowth. This was his third shot to try to get to a championships, and this time he got there and he won the whole thing. So I think he's built quite a bit of experience over the course of this year.
Yeah, definitely. And he put up a good show in the finals, put up a good show throughout the entire time. And standing by with our champion, Hot Meowth, it's Frodan to walk us through his road to be the America's champion.
Thank you very much, TJ. That's right. I'm joined by America's summer champion, Hot Meowth. Congratulations again. I think that definitely
Thank
in
you.
Order. Let's go ahead and just like start off with just the conversation of what really do you think gave you an edge above everyone else at this tournament?
So my lineup, I mainly want to, I guess like I tried to target at first, like try to target like specific lineups, but it didn't work out because like the most meta, like I guess like boring meta decks, the strongest decks are just too strong. So I had to bring the best decks, and I try to like, maybe tech a little bit like to target control. So my line was just like target control and, fare, decently against like other strong meta decks.
Yeah, you specifically brought a very different lineup. You're bringing like Murloc Paladin and stuff. So you wanted to bring that originally to the tournament, but you just felt like it wasn't a good spot, right?
I feel like the problem of like I wanted to bring Freeze Mage and Azu, but the problem is like Murloc Paladin and Freeze Mage. It's a high skill cap deck, and I think I'm not experienced enough. As in like on stream, I would mess up because like the stress level like playing on stream is like a lot like. I don't know, a lot more difficult to play a high level deck on stream than it is on ladder. But I really like combo decks in general. It kind of sucks that I just had to bring like the best boring meta decks to win.
Practice them before BlizzCon, obviously. But you know, we'll be seeing you back for BlizzCon, which is really awesome. Let's go ahead and just walk through each of your wins specifically. It was a lot of games. You know, we don't want to go through all seven of them. But let's just talk about that first win that you're able to get through Hunter. Starting off with Hunter versus Hunter, which was a very fast game now. The Warrior versus Hunter, excuse me. Why don't you talk a little bit about what was the key to this matchup, in your opinion?
I feel like I wanted to kill in Hunter first, second. Because, like, after he won Zoo against Shaman, like, I think my best bet was, like, Hunter. Because like, it's pretty decent against, like, his other decks since, like, Zoo is gone. And I know, like, he's kind of shows me as a person that will just kill, like, the deck that has like the best probability against like all overall against all the decks. So Hunter is a pretty good choice against Warrior, and that's why I chose it in this. And it's pretty straightforward. I don't know. This is not much to say, but like you just have to keep up the aggression and like just don't give the board to him. So there it is.
You mentioned that Warrior was banned every time against you, which. People tend to look at the best performing decks based off wins, but you know we can also look at bans being a sign of strength. Do you really think that Warrior was that strong, or do you feel like people misplaced their ban?
I think it's pretty strong because like I brought Control Warrior. It's Cypher and Rusty's list. Rusty took out Bloodthraker for Doomsayer, but that deck is really strong against like most of the like strong meta decks. I think that's the reason why people ban it. Like of course like Monsanto dude like ban it because they have Freeze Mage and combo decks, and it generally does well against it. So. I can't understand the reason like why they just banned it. And I kind of want to bring Control War running Dragon War, because like last time I banned, I played Dragon War, people won't ban it, so I need a ban target, and I don't want them to ban my Shaman, because like I'm most comfortable playing like with my aggro Shaman and mid range Shaman.
Do you feel like Hunter is a good deck to play on ladder for people who just want to start climbing their way to ACT next year?
Hunter, I say it's best against like control and mid range decks, like slower decks. Mm-hmm. Against aggro decks like Shaman, it kind of struggles a little bit, so I would say my Hunter deck is better against aggressive decks, but I just kind of bring it like 4th and 5th deck, because like, I think Ladder Rise is just like Druid, Shaman, Warrior. Okay. Too strong, those three classes.
Fair enough. Speaking of Shaman, the second win that you're able to get, which, you know, ended up pulling you back into the series because you started off 0-2. What's some of the keys to this Shaman deck that you feel? Because it does have some other tools like Maelstrom Portal, but you only had one of them. Some people are including different techs and whatnot, and you also had Lightning Storm. So what was the reasoning behind some of these choices in Shaman?
I just think like with one Maelstrom Portal and one Storm, it's just like a good balance of like how aggressive you want to be, and you can always come back against like mirrors, like Shaman mirrors and like Zoo. You can always come back with Lightning Storm and Maelstrom. So it fares like a little bit better against like aggressive mirrors, I guess, like aggro mirrors or mid-range mirror like Druid, since like if they run token Druid, Maelstrom is pretty good and Lightning Storm is pretty good too. But I originally wanted to bring mid-range Shaman, but it didn't make sense because I banned mid-range Shaman over Warrior, and I think aggro Shaman fares a little bit better against the Warrior decks people bring. I don't know if it makes sense. People probably like, think a mid-range Shaman is good against Dragon Warrior and Controller, but I like to stick with my comfort picks. That's why I just brought the aggro Shaman I got top 15 with last season.
Yeah, I mean, you were posting screenshots of when you hit number one, right, with it, and then eventually
showing off.
Yeah, no worries, man. I'd show off. Feel free to brag anytime you hit number one, and make sure to, of course, posting the list is good for information there.
Of course, it's not my list; it's Sixil's list. But you go. The Maelstrom, my Lightning Storm attack is what makes it like slightly better for me.
Okay, fair enough. For the tournament, I mean, it seemed to work out fine.
Yeah.
Cool. The third deck is the Warlock deck that you brought. Now, this one has been contentious, and I think Brian Kibler said like 5 or 6 times that you didn't feel confident in it. Mm-hmm. After the tournament and seeing that you won with it in your lineup, do you still feel the same way?
I feel like the problem with Zoo is like Karazhan just released like not long ago. So
yeah, 2 weeks ago.
There's not like a perfect Zoo list, so it's still kind of experimental with this card lock. But it's like, I think this card lock is slightly better than standard Zoo, even though like, I think Taurei Zoo is better in this tournament, just cause it's a safer pick and it worked out for him too. So I think my Zoo deck is, it's all right. It's kind of unrefined, so there might be a better list. But I have faith in Muzzy, even though like it's kind of like it's like first few days of a season, so it's kind of hard to tell like if it's good or not. But it ended up doing all right.
Yeah, it did. I mean, it got the wins, which is the most important thing. I think people are always like very interested in the specific card choice. So, why are you, or why Muzzy, if you talk to him, or why do you like Demon Fire in the list? Because that is a very unusual card.
I think Muzzy kind of talked to Dude or something. Like they didn't expect like people to bring his deck because like it's kind of like still experimental. But
he was messing around. Essentially.
he was just messing around. But like, I got to Legend this season with Muzzy's Zoo deck, so I kind of had faith from there on, so I just brought it because I want to try something new.
Yeah, sure. I mean, and it's funny too because Abar also trusted it too, and you guys ended up bringing a similar list as well. Too bad it didn't work out as well for him. Do you feel like this Zoo Warlock and his build is ladder viable? You said you got to Legend with it, but how far do you think you can really go? Is it like a top tier deck, or is it just like a deck that you can play with other
I don't
ones?
Know if it's the hotel Wi-Fi, but once I got Legend with my Zoo deck, like, I played a Zoo deck a few times in at the hotel where I'm staying. I kept losing. Like sometimes it's disconnect. Sometimes I don't know. Like it feels like my opponent not draw. But I'm currently like almost bottom Legend, trying to get back up there.
You're giving more excuses for for why people can't hit Legend. Oh, yeah, if I had more time and my hotel Wi-Fi was better. But yeah. I know. I'm just kidding. I disconnected a couple of times as well. So yeah. Happens. It's frustrating, of course. The fourth deck is Druid. Now, people are putting Druid as just, you know, one of the top two classes in the game right now. The deck, despite it being a little bit hard, is also extremely flexible and powerful. What do you personally rank Druid right now? People are saying it might be even the best, even though Shaman has the best win percentages.
Best deck in the game.
You think so?
Yeah, 6-0 Faith Druid. It's like, I think Faith is Korean Pro. I don't remember, but it's made by 6-0 and Faith, and I feel like it's just like near perfect. Like some people like don't like it because like they don't have Ancient of Wars and like they don't have the token back hedge, so it might be weaker against like I guess aggressive decks, but or I guess like Chargers in general. But I feel like this deck is just good. Like the Auctioneer, like it's just like you just always have steam because you have two Nourish and Auctioneer. Like sometimes you just ramp up with Nourish, so it's just a pretty broken deck.
Are you? You mentioned 6-0 a lot, and as you're crediting him with a lot of the influence on your lineup, is he practicing with you, or are you just kind of observing him from a distance, hoping that Senpai knows?
Well, he didn't practice me. He's just good at like deck building, and he always has a good deck, so kind of always net deck him because he's just that good.
Well, there you go. The true secret comes out to success in Hearthstone Champions Tour. Apparently, you're just copying decks from 6-0.
Well, I change a few cards, but
right. Of course, I'm just.
His decks are really good.
Yeah, certainly. I can't disagree with that. And you've seen players like Frozen and Muzzy also use his deck to climb very high as well. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, that's pretty much all of the decks here. Is there, before I give off my spiel and end the show, is there any people you want to thank as well or kind of last comments you want to make? Because you are a very interesting figure that's qualified for BlizzCon. We have personalities all across the board, but you're very unique.
Maybe I'll try to be less edgy, and with the prize money, I'll do a makeover and get a new haircut and
Don't let anyone criticize your hairstyle.
Try to become a stud. Learn to become a stud with a better attitude. But
maybe you should work on your riffs and guitar chords first.
Yeah, I just want to shout out to like all the people who helped me practice to help me get to like the championship and win from there. Like shout out to Derpy Troller, Curdy, 97 Gallon, Demigod. They're like they're part of the Skype group called it was Team KYS, but it's kind of inappropriate. So now it's Team XD. So it's still a meme. So
still triggers me.
Yeah. But yeah, thanks to my family, my mom, my sister. It's like everyone who supports me. It's just like I thank them a lot, and everyone on Twitter like they just like really helped me. So.
Awesome.
I proved through, so I'm happy.
All right. Well, congratulations once again, Hot Meowth. You're going to BlizzCon representing the Americas region, and that is it for the summer season for this region. The only person that's going to be able to qualify is through Last Call next month, which brings us, by the way, to our championship schedule. We are going to be broadcasting next week at 9 a.m. Pacific, same channel here at twitch.tv/playHearthstone, September 24th to 25th. Watch retweet performances by George C. and Dr. Hippie go up against the field of the European players. And, of course, on September 30th and October 1st at 9 p.m. Pacific, we're going to have the Asia-Pacific Summer Championship, which I personally hope we get to see Ping Ping Ho again, because that'd be funny for three seasons in a row. Or maybe Handsome Guy makes a return as well. Find out then in 2 weeks. But until then, we are done here. So from Frodan, the casters, the players, and everyone here for the Hearthstone Championship Tour, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week for Europe.